My name is Andy Kuhns. I work for the Illinois Natural History Survey, which is part of the Prairie Research Institute within the University of Illinois. There, I serve as an associate research scientist in the Biotic Surveys and Assessment Program, which is all a big mouthful, but basically I'm a herpetologist. I study amphibians and reptiles. My main focus there in the Biotic Survey and Assessment Program is working on transportation projects. So whenever there's an endangered or threatened species that could be impacted by roads, bridges, railroad tracks, multi-use trails, bike paths, I go out and do the surveys for both the species and potential habitat that would be usable for endangered species. Additionally, it's kind of a split appointment. The rest of my time I spend doing conservation type research throughout the state, again specifically on amphibians and reptiles. I try to do work that can have some application for conservationists and people within DNR, so they can take the results of our work and really use it to assess and manage for those endangered species and their habitats.
Can you tell us a little bit about your current research project?
Sure. We're out here at Kickapoo State Park. This research is funded by a state wildlife grant administered from the Illinois Department of Natural Resources. Myself with some colleagues, John Crawford at the National Great Rivers Research and Education Center in East Alton, Illinois, and Michael Dreslick and Chris Phillips, also at the Natural History Survey, are doing a study on the population demographics of the silvery salamander. In that, we're trying to assess population sizes, growth of the individuals. We're also attempting to look at fecundity, production, so how many females are going into the ponds, how many eggs are they laying, how many larvae actually survive to metamorphosis and exit the ponds. So we are here, we have drift fences set up, and they're used to intercept salamanders as they come to the ponds. They walk along the fences and drop into 5-gallon buckets, and then we can check them and see who they are and ID them and measure and weigh them, and then we move them on into the pond so they can go about their breeding business.
Why is this a good time to see salamanders and work with silvery salamanders?
This is about the only time you can find silvery salamanders during the year. The rest of the year, they're below ground, going down little burrows or under logs or stuff. Sometimes they come up after rains, but spring is the best time to find them because that's when they do their migrations to their breeding pools, like you can see behind us. So usually the first spring rains, late winter rains, as soon as the ground thaws, the salamanders come up and they head to their wetlands to breed. They're in there, males are in there maybe up to a month. Females usually come in, lay their eggs, and then leave.
So Andy, tell us briefly about the silvery salamanders and why are they so interesting to study?
They're a very unusual organism in that they are unisexual. There are no males. They are triploid, so they have 3 sets of chromosomes instead of 2, and they reproduce by stealing the sperm from smallmouth salamanders. They don't actually use the sperm, but they need the sperm metaphors from the male taxanum to kind of get things rolling and getting the eggs to develop. The males go around on the bottom of the pond and they deposit little stalks of spermatophores, the sperm at the tip of this stalk, and then the females walk along and reach down and grab them and pick them up with their cloacal lips. Very tricky to get that movement lined up and everything just right.
Is there anything else about the silvery salamanders, any interesting tidbits that you'd like to share?
Sure. One thing I haven't mentioned yet is I did say that they were a unisexual species and all females. They arose, came to be through a hybridization between 2 different species of salamanders, the Jefferson salamander and the blue-spotted salamander. And what happened there is their chromosomes got mixed up, so our silvery salamanders here have 2 sets of chromosomes from the Jefferson salamander and 1 from the blue-spotted salamander. Now, what's interesting around here is we have silvery salamanders, but we don't have Jefferson salamanders and we don't have blue-spotted salamanders. Normally, in other parts of the country where silvery salamanders, these JJLs as they're known, lots of places, they use either the Jefferson salamander or the blue-spotted salamander as their sperm donor. Here, since we don't have either of those species, another thing that's very unique about them here is that they use the smallmouth salamander males' spermatophores to reproduce. So another unique difficulty in working with silvery salamanders is that even though they are endangered, they require this common species, the smallmouth salamander, in order to reproduce. So you need to manage not only for the silvery salamander, but also for the smallmouth salamander. And you would think that would be relatively easy because they breed in the same habitats, they use the same habitat, but basically what is happening is the silvery salamanders are stealing spermatophores from the smallmouths, which means there's less available for the smallmouth salamander females to reproduce. We've had some years out here where we've only had one or two male Texanum show up at the wetlands. So it's kind of a difficulty because normally the smallmouth salamander is kind of considered like a pigeon. They're everywhere and they're common. But here, where they have almost a sexual predator, we have to worry about them a little more than you would anywhere else.
Can you tell us a little bit about the status of silvery salamanders in Illinois?
Sure. Unfortunately, they're state endangered. They're only known from a relatively few places in the state. They were originally found up here, kind of right behind where the camera is, in the late 80s. And that was the only pond that we knew them to occur in the entire state. Subsequently, in the last few years, we've been branching out our surveys, and we have them in around a dozen ponds now in Vermilion County. We also observed them at a different site down in Crawford County at a state park there, but we haven't really branched out surveys farther from that state park. It's a little more difficult to get onto private lands and do surveys there. So they're mainly endangered due to a restricted range. This is the farthest west that they occur in the country, and they just kind of barely make it into Illinois in the counties right along the Indiana border.
Is habitat loss part of why there are so few silvery salamanders?
Possibly. Of course, Illinois has been highly modified since we came around. So I think it was always a very restricted range. This is just about as far west as they can go. But certainly there has been fragmentation of habitat and habitat loss that kind of split up the population. So they're just found in little pockets here and there now, whereas before they probably would have been much more abundant, at least within the part of Illinois that they occur in now.
So Andy, what is ideal habitat for silvery salamanders?
They like closed canopy deciduous woodlots with an abundance of leaf litter. Another thing that's very important for their survival is that there needs to be ephemeral ponds somewhere in the vicinity so that they can go to breed. Ephemeral ponds in much of Illinois are very hard to come by, especially those in woodlots. There are very few natural wetlands, ephemeral wetlands, that stay deep enough so that salamanders can reproduce and their larvae can grow up and metamorphose before the ponds dry out.
What are ephemeral pools?
They're temporary wetlands. They typically fill up with snowmelt in the winter, early spring rains, and usually by July or August, they dry out. That's important for salamanders and other amphibians because if the ponds and wetlands dry out, there won't be fish in them. Fish eat salamander larvae and salamander eggs. So you really kind of want a wetland that holds water for 6 months, 8 months, or one that's shallow enough that even if it keeps water, it freezes solid in the winter, and that prevents fish from becoming established in those wetlands and make it a nice ephemeral wetland for amphibians.
Why were these ephemeral pools reshaped earlier this fall?
Sure. With created ephemeral wetlands, it's always kind of a balancing act between having enough water that stays there long enough, but not so much water that fish or, you know, other amphibians such as bullfrogs can become established and predate the critters you're trying to take care of. So what we had happen last year is we have two created wetlands up here along with a natural wetland. The natural wetland is very shallow. It doesn't fill every year. So they put in these created wetlands as kind of a buffer. So in case the natural wetland does not reproduce does not get salamanders coming out of it for several years, they created these wetlands here. What happened last year is all the ponds dried by June. So we had no recruitment at this site. So the two created ponds, since they're not in a nature preserve, we were able to go in and just reshape them a little bit, make them a little bit bigger and a little bit deeper. So hopefully they won't dry too soon in the future.